so long since last we met.
Lie down forever, lie down. Or have you any money to bet? Lie down forever, lie down. There goes old Georgetown, straight for a touchdown. See how they gain ground. Lie down forever, lie down,
lie down,
lie down forever, lie down.
Hello, and welcome to 1789 Seconds, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. It's great to see so many of you on the line today. Thanks for taking the time to be with us. Throughout this series, we'll spend 1,789 seconds, or just about 30 minutes, with amazing alumni as they tell their amazing stories. I'm Julia Farr from the College Class of 1988, and I'm the parent of three Hoyas, 2019, 21, and 24. I'm also the Executive Director of the Alumni Association here at Georgetown. I'm joined today in conversation with another Hoya, Sarah Trahern, from the College Class of 1986. Sarah is also the CEO of the Country Music Association. Welcome, Sarah. Thanks for being here with us.
It's great to be with you today, Julie.
It really has been so long since last we met. It was just about a month ago we were together in Nashville as we were planning our John Carroll weekend 2022, which we can't wait to come and bring to your fabulous city. So it was great to meet you then and great to be with you today. I'm going to jump right in because we really now just have fewer than 1789 seconds to start our conversation. Today, we're going to talk about the country music industry. We're going to talk about your career. We're going to talk about trends, and we're going to hear some fun stories from you. So I'm going to jump in today to hear about the CMA Awards. We're just about a little bit over a week ago. I think we have to start there. I watched a lot of parts of it. There were a lot of tears from artists when they received their awards, which was great, high emotion, and a lot of joy with it. And I know we have an alum also, Jim McCormick, who was part of writing Gabby Barrett's song, The Good Ones. So that was very exciting. Tell us what goes into the making of the CMA Awards.
Oh, gosh. And, you know, there are so many moving parts. I love doing live television. It is my favorite thing in the world to do. And we celebrated our 55th annual CMA Awards a week ago Wednesday from Bridgestone Arena. We were able to keep a show going last year in front of artists only in a protected environment. But this year we were in the arena with a vaxxed or tested audience and an all tested every 2 days celebrity community. So I think during the week I was tested maybe 5 to 7 times, you know, just to get to the program. But we're able to do a safe program, which was amazing for everyone. I think it was one of the reasons there was so much excitement in the community is that it's the first time our industry really has been back together on that scale since 2019. There was a moment when we had already loaded in and I'd been working backstage with our crew, but I had not gone into the bowl yet to see the setup. And I was on my way to a security meeting at 8 a.m. and I just walked by one of the entrances and peered in. And all I could remember was seeing the last time we were there, Dolly and Reba and Carrie Underwood when they hosted in 2019. And it was just, the emotion hit me that it had been 2 years since we'd done it. Suddenly the fact it had been 2 full years since we'd been back there doing it, you know, just struck such emotion for people. And I think it's one of the things that made that night particularly special. But it, you know, there are a lot of moving parts with an award show like that. You have the live 3-hour show. We were on ABC. We are now on Hulu. So people who would like to see it and haven't seen it, I hope you guys will go check it out on Hulu for the next 30 days. And then, you know, certainly our marketing team, so, you know, moving parts with coordinating with, we had a live shot with Good Morning America, and we don't have our normal red carpet set up because of COVID. So we were able to do that in the media room. Just a lot of things, learnings from adapting to doing television in COVID. But I'm really, really proud of the show.
Yeah, congratulations. From everything I saw, it was just excellent. You know, you mentioned you walked by and saw Carrie and Reba and Dolly. That's pretty crazy to hear from my end. Do you still have those moments where you're just wowed by the people that you're with, or is it sort of run of the mill?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I personally love to see nice people win, and we really get to work with an amazing group of people in our business. I did have a little fangirl moment at our award show because I don't always go talk to the big celebrities that come in just because I'm busy doing stuff and I don't need to. Like our Robert Deaton, our executive producer, does that. And I'd taken our Hulu and ABC execs to go talk to Nicole Kidman because she has a show on Hulu, and you know, they wanted to talk to her, and she was in an area where they couldn't get to. So I made that happen, and I'm just standing there waiting to walk them back off the floor. And I'm right in front of Jennifer Hudson, who joined us to sing Aretha Franklin's, some of the Willie Nelson songs that Aretha Franklin recorded when she did some country songs. And I'm just standing there, like, you know, she's kind of sitting in her chair, and I'm just standing there. I'm like, okay, well, I just need to talk to her. So, you know, I introduced myself, and I talked about how wonderful it was to have her with us at the show, and her performance was incredible. And she was so genuine and nice, and talked very specifically about the treatment she got by our team and being at the show. And, you know, you like it when the people are as nice as you expect them to do. And to be, when I moved here from DC, you know, people, you know, said, you know, what's, you know, in DC they have, you know, politicians might have no hair, and country music artists back in the day had big hair, you know, and, but, you know, politicians have chief of staffs, artists have managers. There's a lot of similarities to it. But my very first project I did was a Marty party, a show hosted by Marty Stewart. And the guests were Alan Jackson, Junior Brown, and Johnny Cash. And I remember being in the control room. You know, I moved here 6 weeks before. And, you know, Cash comes out and does that, "Hello, I'm Johnny Cash." And you're like, this is a legend. This is Johnny Cash. And, you know, I had to pinch myself that this was my job. And there's still those moments today when I have that feeling.
Oh, so exciting. Well, let's jump into country music itself. It's always been a mainstay for us in the United States. It's really taking over the world right now. I read there's an explosive revival of country beyond the U.S., but certainly within our country, too. What's fueling this drive?
You know, I think for a long time, people considered country just an American format. And certainly a lot of the songs is known for strong songwriting and storytelling. And I think a lot of people, you know, think about relating to family. You know, there's the jokes about trucks, beer, you know, trains and grandma. But there's also the real life stories about heartbreak and loss and elation and pride and those are universal people themes. Those aren't necessarily American themes. And it's one of the things that's been most exciting to me in my 8 years that I've been at CMA, even though I've been in the country business now for 25 years, has been to watch the growth, certainly in English-speaking countries like America and UK and Australia, where things have taken off dramatically. But we're seeing, you know, great strides in countries like Germany and China and other places where the music's taking off as well.
Read that over about 51% of U.S. Adults listen to country music, that the audience now reaches more than 139 million U.S. teens and adults, and there's a 9% listener growth in just the past 5 years. So it is on the rise. We have more growth with millennials than anyone else. I grew up with country music from my father, who's 96, but also really learned it again from my kids, who are 25, 23, and 19. It's on all our family Spotify lists. So I started listening just probably 10 years ago because of my kids.
Right. I think the streaming growth has been huge. I mean, if you look at particularly during the pandemic, country as a format still held on a physical product for a long time. Mm-hmm. And we were not the most innovative. I think as an industry back in the 90s, our head was a little bit in the sand with regard to the technology changes. But it really grew rapidly, you know, starting about 5 years ago. And frankly, the pandemic really helped that. A lot of people who were later adopters, started paying for streaming rather than even just free streaming over the last 2 years. I think people during the pandemic wanted both that warm hug of the familiar music that they heard or grew up with, like the stuff you heard. But I also am excited about, and it's funny for me to say this as someone who is the Country Music Association, but in the new kind of more or less format driven world, it means more people come in and out of country, more people come in and out of rock or hip hop because of the excitement of the music and the artists. So a playlist might just, you know, you have people who would go to a country playlist, but you might also have an artist that's on a crossover playlist, whether it's a Carrie Underwood or Miranda Lambert, that people come in and go, "Oh, I really like that." You know, years ago, I remember, you know, talking to a group and people said, "I don't like country music at all." And it's when Need You Now, the song by Lady A, was on both the pop charts and on the country charts at the top of them. And I'm like, well, do you like this song? Oh, I love that. Well, they're country art. Or, you know, Karen Underwood is on the, you know, opening of football. She's a country artist, you know. So I think streaming has broadened that in a really exciting way. I think, you know, that you mentioned Jim McCormick, and I don't know who wins until the envelopes get opened at the awards.
I didn't know that.
So I have no clue. So I always Chris Stapleton's song was great. I would have loved to have a Julia with the CMA award at home. So maybe Jim will come back and, you know, win another one. But ironically, I do know the nominees, and I had lunch with Jim or breakfast with Jim, and I knew he was a nominee. It hadn't been announced yet, and I'm just sitting like, oh yeah. And a couple weeks when it came out, I couldn't wait to text him and say, you know, Julia on the show. So but you know, there's another young artist that I'm very excited about, and I really encourage Julia's to check out. His name is Breland. He is a graduate of the business school. He's been on a couple of our shows now. He's also on our CMA Country Christmas show, which airs the Monday after Thanksgiving. So for those of you who like a good Christmas holiday show, check out ABC. But he is one of those people who has a brand and a format called Cross Country. And so he's out riding with himself and a hip hop writer, or he was invited to go quarantine with Keith Urban in Australia for 2 weeks and, you know, wrote, I don't know how many songs that he and Keith wrote together, but it's exciting to me to see this next generation of artists, you know, bending the format a little bit. I mean, there's space for everybody in what I think is the big tent of music. Yeah. So I mean, I think the, back to your question about the growth, I think the pandemic was a bad thing in a lot of ways. I do think people listen to a lot of music. And I think one of the things that helped country was that the artists experienced the same thing everybody else in the world did. It's not just what happened in the US, it's what happened to our country fans in Australia, our country fans in the UK. So Keith Urban might do a home concert from Australia where he was quarantined, but fans here in America could relate because he and his wife and his kids were quarantined together in the same way that we experienced that. And I think that universality of the experience actually also contributed to the growth over the last year.
It's been described as a living, breathing, evolving art form. And just that experience that we were all a part of in the pandemic, I think really rang through. I also saw that some careers were launched through TikTok. So, I mean, it's just little bites where an artist could launch their career. You know, you get off the airplane in Nashville and everyone's playing music, and every place you walk into, music just falling out of the windows. How hard is it to be discovered in Nashville if you show up with your guitar and just sit down and start playing?
Yeah, it's one of the things I was going to encourage when the folks come to the John Carroll Weekend to know is that we're not just country. There's a lot of different kinds of music coming out of Nashville, and one of my favorites, blues artist Keb Moe, is here, and Peter Frampton is here, and for a long time Donna Summer was here, and it really is known as such a songwriting town. But if you go down Broadway or Second Avenue, Julie, where I know you were down there a couple weeks ago, coming out of any bar or restaurant, the musicians are just good, kind of a great Nashville good, and any one of them, for a bunch of things lining up one way or another, could be a superstar. They're really, the talent is that good. And a lot of people who come to town may be, you know, famous in their small town, and people who have those aspirations, but they may not be that solid. It takes so many things to line up for someone to have, you know, that lightning in a bottle. But I will say, and encourage everybody to come to Nashville, that there's something for everyone, but everybody's really good.
You mentioned before widening the tent. Let me turn to that for a second. You created a brand identity for country music really at the highest level. You've been at the forefront of some of the industry's most ambitious initiatives, fostering gender equality, inclusion, and really preserving the legacy of country music. You mentioned it, you know, back in the day, it was all about your truck and your dog and your achy, breaky heart. But now country really has embraced diversity as a key theme. What have you done to create this brand identity?
You know, if you look at the macro world that we exist in, country is not the same country that it was in 1968, or, you know, the makeup of people, the diversity of opinion, the diversity of racial, ethnic backgrounds, and, you know, country music needs to reflect that. You know, what we've had struggles. I mean, I cannot atone for what took place 20 years ago in our industry. I wasn't here 25, 30 years ago, but I am responsible for what CMA does today going forward. And we are really committed to being more inclusive as an industry. For those of you who watched the show, we had more artists of color on our program this year than we ever have before. Two of them actually were nominees. One of them won. Great experience with them. We actually have, we've had a number of gay or openly gay artists in the format over the years, but not an openly gay superstar like we have now in TJ Osborne, who won an award and then did a very moving song about the experience of what he would say back to his younger me, dealing with not being out yet and then the process of coming out. That's not what people would normally expect of country music, and I'm really proud that we can represent that and more traditional country at the same time. It's where the country is. We have just completed a multicultural fan study that we're rolling out in a few weeks to our industry to make sure we know the trends of what Black and Brown fans want to listen to and how we broaden that out and really, you know, position ourselves to help lead the industry, you know, in 2022 and going forward to making sure that we're as representative as we should be.
Is there a concern within your industry that you potentially lose the legacy of country music by widening this tent, by making these moves?
No, I mean, I think there will always be that criticism. I mean, I've been in Nashville now since 1995. But if you look back to our history, even in the 70s, there was, you know, a period where, you know, maybe in the 60s, even Eddie Arnold was with strings and, you know, and traditional country sound, rich sound. And you've got Waylon and Willie doing and Buck Owens, kind of the West Coast edgier sound. And they had their own big tent challenges back then. You know, I listened to Olivia Newton-John in the 70s, and she was up for a CMA award, and she was on pop radio, and there was a controversy. Oh my gosh, you know, Olivia Newton-John or John Denver wins a CMA award. How crazy is that? He's a rock or pop guy, you know. So there's all, you know, the big tent always has people who say, well, that's not us. We're in our tent here. And you need people to push those boundaries. That's where true creativity comes. I also tend to love the traditionalists. And there's room in the business expands, it contracts. You'll have a new traditionalist like Dwight Yoakam was when he came out in the 90s, or Randy Travis. You know, that will pull the music back to the center, but Dwight was doing that with an edgy sound at the same time. So I think that's where, again, I'll be bullish on our fellow Hoya Breland. I think he's doing some really interesting things with the sound and combining some of the hip hop sensibilities. And, you know, music is not static. Music is expressive of the people who are the writers. And I'm really excited about where country is.
Let me take a turn now. Thank you for telling me about that. I want to take a turn and talk about you and your path to where you are now. You've been called curious, focused, eclectic, and determined. You've been described as having foresight and thinking expansively. Tell us a little bit about your moment in leadership for these past many years as an advocate and what it means to be an executive in your industry.
I have the best job in the world. On any given day, I love what I do. The elevator speech is that we are responsible at CMA as a trade association for growing country music around the world. We have a membership base of over 6,000 people worldwide in the industry. We have a board of directors of about 75. So I kind of joke that my DC roots come up because it's trying to get 3/4 of the U.S. Senate focused in the same direction. It's a smart group of people, but sometimes can be a handful to manage. But most days, I mean, it's wonderful because you have an industry where we're focused on the same end goal, There may be different approaches to get there. And I would lie, Julia, if I didn't say that, you know, the last 2 years have been the toughest years as a leader, and tied in with being a civic leader in our city. There's a lot of collaboration. We were talking earlier about Mimi Vaughn, who is runs UNESCO here, who is a Hoya as well. And there's a good business community, whether it's the banking community and healthcare and music and sports, that work with each other. And on a call, the bunch of us right at the beginning of the pandemic, they said, you know, well, what do we do? And you said, well, leaders lead. Like, this is what you do. It doesn't mean it's easy. But, you know, if I sit there and look back at the last 2 years, I don't think I'm so ready for it to be new, kind of new normal. Our staff came in yesterday to do a post-fest celebration. And, you know, we're almost all vaccinated and people still have their masks and whatever, but we were together.
Yeah, that's right.
And I truly believe that the power of the collective and the diversity of ideas and passion is what pushes us forward. And the first year I was proud of our group and how well we worked remotely. The second year I realized how much we lost by not being together.
Yeah, it was time to come back together. You mentioned to me the last time we spoke about the idea of bravery in your career and how you mentor a lot of younger professionals and encourage them to be brave to strike out and try something new and perhaps forge a new path and then come back around again. Tell me about your role in mentoring those younger in your profession and your advice to them.
Yeah, you know, one of the things that I used to be a trustee for many years for the Georgetown Baker Scholar Program for liberal arts kids going into business. And while I always had amazing young mentees in the program, I suddenly became the person that a lot of folks called in their 20s, late 20s, when they were ready for a career change. And probably because I've had a lot of pivots in my career to get to what I'm doing today, which is amazing. But so I started my career in DC covering politics for C-SPAN, not right after graduation. I did a different job, but about 8 months after graduation. And I love it. To this day, I left C-SPAN in 1995. And to this day, I'm still really good friends with a lot of people who were there when I was there. And until recently, and some changes during the pandemic, about 40% of their workforce was there when I was there, which is a lot of people 26 years later. And also, frankly, all of the people who were in positions above me of seniority 25 years later are still there. Yeah. So I had to leave to grow. And the supervisors there to this day are really supportive of that. Like, they get it. And I feel the same way on our team. Sometimes we don't have the opportunities for people to grow where they are, and you have to move to follow your passion. And so I've made a couple of those leaps, sometimes smarter than others. and I'm sure most of the people on the call have done that. But I think those leaps of faith and following your passion are really important, and not necessarily, we're not the same business where we're going to stay where our grandfathers might have stayed 45 years and gotten a watch. You know, I tend to kind of be 10 years at places. So
I've done the same. It's all about the uncharted path that leads to your growth. So we've danced around a little bit that we both went to Georgetown University, and we mentioned some Hoyas on the call, from Mimi Vaughn to Breland, Jim McCormick. Let's talk about your time at Georgetown. You graduated in 1986. Tell me about your time here.
Oh, I love the Hilltop. My parents accused me of choosing my colleges by the basketball teams because I loved college basketball. I really wanted to go to North Carolina because I was a Dean Smith fan and liked the Tar Heels, and I didn't get in. I got into Duke. Georgetown won out, which was a great fit for me. I came in wanting to study government. I ended up changing to American Studies at a time when I was thinking about leaving. And Hugh Cloak, I went in to meet with him, said, I'm thinking of transferring. He said, I really think you need to think about American Studies. And that move changed my Georgetown career, but also, frankly, what I learned in through that program is probably the skills that I use the most today, because in, you know, through American studies, you're synthesizing something from your English class and something from your history class and something from government, and really all of the threads that pull through as a business leader, that's what you have to do. And particularly leading an organization with a large board, how do you synthesize these inputs to be able to create a path forward?
Do you have a favorite memory from the Hilltop?
Oh my gosh. I said the year that we won the national championship in basketball was pretty good. I was not there. I was on the campus, but just remember being in the dorm and just the screams throughout the campus. There was also a year there where the Redskins won Super Bowl. And I remember being in Harbin with my little black and white, you know, TV with a dial. It shows you how old I am. And watching, you know, that happen in the NFL game, and then hearing the screams from down in the Georgetown area. You know, I love DC. It still feels like home to go back. And there's something beautiful about walking through the campus, either late at night or early morning, that still just takes you back to when you were on the Hilltop as well.
Absolutely. I live on the edge of campus on 36 and 0, and it was a really great moment last year when we won the Big East. Because it felt like something I had experienced many, many moons ago. And my son was a freshman at the time and sophomore now. And the streets filled up in Georgetown. And although, you know, the students weren't supposed to congregate or anything like that in the middle of the pandemic, they rushed up to the gates and the screaming and yelling and the whole thing. It really brought me back. And it was so great to feel that again after so much time of being inside our home, saying all that's alive and well in the world. And the Hoyas are back.
Well, and sometimes when I talk to young people in their first jobs, and they say, I don't know how I would handle this. And I became a manager really early in my career at C-SPAN. I managed a staff of people who were all older than me, and two of them didn't get along. And I didn't know how to handle it. And I just realized it was a roommate conflict. It's just what I learned as an RA is, how am I going to apply that to these people who share an office? And I think particularly when I speak to young people, you have inputs from things you've done, whether it's from volunteering, whether it's from your college experience, that actually you can pull into the workforce, is again, just thinking about, what have I experienced that's a similar situation? So on occasion, when I speak to young people and use that reference, it takes me back to my memories and RA training and my friends from that time.
That's excellent. I'm gonna remember that, roommate issues. We just have about 2 or 3 minutes left. So if you can share a great story that you'd like to tell everyone listening today that you've experienced in the last several years down in Nashville, we would love to hear it. And then maybe if you want to run into that, talk about what we should absolutely see or do when we're in Nashville at the beginning of April in 2022.
Yeah. You know, there's so many good stories, and this is a more personal one, but CMA has a foundation that supports music education all around the country. We feel that all students should have access to learning music, not for them to be the next generation of Dolly Partons or Carrie Underwoods or Luke Bryans, but because music creates a path to self-expression and collaboration, all those things. So we have the foundation. It's funded by our big event, Music Fest, which happens every summer. It hasn't happened the last two summers because of the pandemic. So watch out. Nashville's going to be crazy June of 2022. But my very first year, I was staying at a hotel downtown, and the hotel brought me some wine and cheese as a thank you for bringing all these people in. And we had pictures. I send the artists thank you notes from the students that we've supported. And they were all spread out on my desk at the hotel. And the guy came to bring my wine. I went to get a tip for him. And he said, what do you know about this Disney musicals and schools program? Because there's pictures of the kids. And I said, oh, well, I'm with CMA. We support that. You know, we're the major funder, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, what do you know? And he said, my son played Simba in the 8th grade last year, and it changed his life. And I'm like, how did it change his life? And he said, you know, he was hanging out with a group of kids. I'm a single dad. I work 2 jobs. I wasn't able to be there a lot, and he started to hang out with this group, and this program gave him a group of kids to work with and to learn and whatever. And he also said that he'd been really shy, and it gave him a voice, and the music gave him a means of self-expression. And that program is specifically funded because of all the work we do at Music Fest. And I think it's one of those things that we as Hoyas value is the ability to pay it forward, even through the business side. I mean, we're a money-making venture at CMA and the Fest and a TV show and all those, but we got to pay it forward to kids. And that was my very first CMA Fest in this role. And there's not a year that goes by that I don't get grounded back to why we're so blessed to get to do what we do. And so blessed to do that and live in Nashville. So I really do encourage everybody, you know, to come for our John Carroll weekend. Julie and the team have put together a great, great lineup, but the city itself is just a fun city. I mean, certainly there's the programmatic pieces that we're working on in Nashville, but you can't stumble out of the JW Marriott Hotel without running into a museum or music or sports. You know, Nashville has a little bit of something for everyone. It's I think the number two city for millennials to come to in America right now to move. We are in the top tourist city as well. So get ready for a busy week.
We can't wait to come join you there. Sarah, I can't thank you enough for spending these last 1789 seconds with all of us. And we look forward to seeing you in the spring in Nashville. Hoya Sachs to everyone, and thank you for joining us today.
Thanks all.
Bye.
Bye.